and thank you for joining me for this featured session. Singing Box 331, resounding 18th century Mohican hymns from the Moravian Archives. I'm Sarah Ierley, and I'm an associate professor of musicology at Florida State University, and I also direct the early music program. As a musicologist, my main research area is hymnody, and specifically the use of hymnody in 18th century mission contexts. And so I'll be talking a little bit about a large-scale collaborative research project this afternoon that I've been involved in to reconstruct and resound 18th century Mohican hymn texts from the archives of the Moravian Church in Bethlehem, Pennsylvania. This project began as an attempt by Rachel Wheeler, a religious historian, and myself to gain a fuller understanding of historic traditions of Mohican language hymnody at Moravian mission sites in Pennsylvania, New York, and Connecticut, and within the Moravian Church more broadly, by combining insights from the disciplines of religious studies and musicology in service of singing this repertory again. But like many large collaborative projects, it has since evolved to include a number of different collaborators who also have a stake in this history. Members of the Stockbridge Muncie Band of Mohican Indians, a Mohican descendant community, professional Mohican musicians and composers, a scholar in linguistics, recording professionals, congregation members from the Church of the Wilderness in Bowler, Wisconsin, and students at Florida State University and the University of Wisconsin at Whitewater. Together, my collaborators and I have traced the history of the creation of Mohican language hymns at a number of different communities affiliated with the Moravian Church in the mid-18th century. And in the process, we've created a hymnal of Mohican language hymns for use by the Church of the Wilderness as a contribution to their ongoing efforts to incorporate Mohican language into their regular services. And this summer, in a coordination with the Moravian Music Foundation, we will be publishing a version of this hymnal with recordings of 8 hymns. The process of singing these hymns together for the first time in centuries and recording them in 3 different versions, as I will discuss in this video, has proved both deeply moving and instructive. From the outset, uncovering the story of these hymns was a puzzle that none of us could solve alone. Each one of us possessed important knowledge and skills, but it was only by putting the pieces together that we were able to see a fuller picture. Along the way, in constructing that picture and singing these hymns, we have come to appreciate the benefits of collaborative research, particularly when put toward the task of resounding historic religious music repertories. Our desire to hear the music and to sing the hymns again has been motivated by our conviction that the process itself of collaboratively investigating the Mohican hymns has generated important new questions which have shaped our interpretations of 18th century Mohican Moravian hymnody and its contemporary significance. Like much historical research, our project began with a collection of manuscripts. On the shelves in the Moravian Archives in Bethlehem, in box 331 of the Indian Missions collection, sit several small booklets of hymns dating to the 1740s. Their titles announce the language is Mohican. Most verses have a line in German above the native language stanza. At first glance, these documents would seem to be simply translations of popular German Moravian hymns of the time period, but a more careful look reveals them to be far more complex. A number of the Mohican stanzas are attributed to native residents of Moravian communities, and an analysis of their contents demonstrates these stanzas are not translations, but new creations. The German heading indicates a chorale tune to be used rather than a source text. As material objects, the hymn books, or rather you might call them pamphlets, in box 331 are an important but sparse representation of what was once a living, sounded tradition of hymn singing that brought together hundreds of Moravians native and European, in the mid-18th century. These hymns were a significant element of community life in Mohican Moravian communities such as Shecomico, New York, and Gnadenhütten, Pennsylvania. They were sung to and by the sick and the dying. They were sung at gravesides. They were sung by men while hunting. They were sung at communal feasts. They were sung for visitors or when visiting other communities. They were sung to bring comfort, to call spiritual power, and to create and fortify community. And as written documents, the hymn books have become important cultural and linguistic records, silently preserving this tradition of Mohican hymnody for over 250 years. Long before we knew each other, Rachel Wheeler and I had both visited the Moravian Archives in Bethlehem and carefully paged through the hymns in Box 331. As a scholar of American religious history, Rachel's previous work on missions and native adaptations of Christianity sparked her interest in the hymns as a way to explore how Mohicans engaged with Christian ideas. But to proceed with unlocking the meaning of the hymns, she also needed to understand Moravian musical practices and the Mohican language. As a musicologist studying 18th century Moravian music and performance practices, I too had encountered the Mohican hymns in Box 331. I recognized many of the hymn tunes, prompting me to wonder how they might have sounded. But I lacked detailed knowledge of the history of the Moravian missions or the Mohican language, so I filed this idea away for a future project. We had both held these same texts in our hands, wondering how the hymns might have sounded and what they meant to the people who created them. Yet no matter how many years of expertise we had accumulated in our respective scholarly areas of study, these texts remained stubbornly mute until we began conversations with each other and the many others, scholars and members of the Stockbridge-Munsee community, who we came to learn were also interested in studying and singing the Mohican hymns in that same archival collection. The Stockbridge Mohican community descends from Housatonic and Mohican peoples who lived in the traditional Mohican homelands of the Hudson River Valley and the Housatonic Valley in western Massachusetts and Connecticut. In 1735, the residents of two villages accepted the presence of a congregational minister in their midst, hoping for the protections that a New England-style town might offer. In 1740, the first German Moravian missionaries made contact with residents of another Mohican village, Shecomico, roughly 40 miles southwest of Stockbridge in Dutchess County, New York. And here you can see on the map in the little inset at the bottom some of those communities that I've been mentioning, including Shecomico and also Pachacoch. The German Moravians at Shecomico kept extensive records, and those records allowed us to base this project upon contemporary 18th century sources. But the conditions of colonialism in the area led to a quick dissolution of a distinctly Mohican Moravian community in New York, and thus no descendant community survives today from that lineage. The Stockbridges, though, descending from the Christian mission town in Stockbridge, Massachusetts, have long remembered the significant ties of kinship that have bound Stockbridge and Shecomico for centuries. And these ties prompted tribal historians Bernice Miller and Dorothy Davids to seek out resources from the Moravian archives. So beginning in the 1960s, these two sisters undertook a series of trips to libraries, historical societies, and archives in ancestral locations in order to build a collection for the newly founded Arvid Miller Memorial Library on the reservation near Buller, Wisconsin. During a visit to the Moravian Archives sometime in the 1970s, the Stockbridge visitors were guided to the Indian Missions Collection and Box 331 for its wealth of Mohican language materials. Unfortunately, Bernice Miller and Dorothy Davids's hopes that the Moravian sources would provide an accessible source for recovering Mohican history and language were quickly dashed. Archival assistant Lothar Mottaheim later related how these Stockbridge visitors had left dismayed at how inaccessible the Moravian records were because of the difficult 18th century German handwriting. In recent years, though, language efforts in the Stockbridge community have gathered momentum, although the task of language revival has been fraught with challenges that are significant enough to have led some Mohican community members to focus their efforts on learning Munsee rather than Mohican. First, the last native speakers of Mohican died in the 1930s, and those individuals were recalling language they remembered their parents and elders speaking decades earlier. Secondly, the body of archival and printed source material in Mohican is limited. So the Stockbridge Mohican community has sought the help of linguists in their project, including most recently Chris Harvey, who is a doctoral student at the University of Toronto writing his dissertation on the Mohican language. Chris is also collaborating on a grant with the Arvid Miller Library to produce a series of online classes to help community members study Mohican. At the heart of these language revival efforts is Box 331 and its considerable collection of language materials. Thus, the hymns in this collection are incredibly significant as linguistic and cultural records. In the end, our efforts to resound what we thought were obscure hymns led us to realize many others had also visited Box 331 and contemplated the significance of these Mohican language texts. The historical, musical, and linguistic reconstruction of the hymns was like putting together a puzzle. Each person contributed their expertise, in the end making it possible to sing the hymns again. As a historian, Rachel conducted research in the larger Moravian Mission collection with the aim of understanding how these hymns were created through the collaborative work of German missionaries and Native Christians. Through my own research, I was able to identify the chorale tunes indicated by the single line of German that accompanied each hymn. I also considered the significance of polyglot hymnody to the Moravian spiritual project. Yet treating these texts as silent texts to be studied, rather than as a shorthand representation of the embodied communally produced act of congregational singing, felt insufficient. And so we set out to hear and indeed to sing these texts once again. Through the process of attempting to sing the hymns with our collaborators, we gained deeper insight into the web of relationships that facilitated the creation and singing of the Mohican hymns in the 18th century. The rich sources in the Moravian records revealed that these hymns were not simply translations. Instead, Mohicans had called on the missionaries to devote themselves to the study of Mohican with native teachers. And these teachers oversaw the composition of the hymns. Many of the hymns were created by the Mohican leader, Tasawakamen, who had been baptized as Joshua in the Moravian church, and his second wife, Bathsheba, in collaboration with German missionary Johann Christoph Pirlias and his wife Susanna Benezet. This was very much a community-based practice, and the hymns were not written or sung alone. They depended on the collaborative work of individuals such as Joshua and Johann Christoph, Bathsheba and Susanna. It depended on relationships between Native and European Moravians, and between communities who are bound up in structural forces of colonialism, yet whose experience of those forces were mediated through personal, familial, spiritual, and communal relationships. The resulting Mohican language hymns were then put to use in Native communities, such as the one seen in the picture here at Gnadenhütten in Pennsylvania, to carry on various types of ritual work in domestic and communal settings. Hymns were often sung when visitors arrived to town or when delegations traveled to other communities. Thus, it became clear to us these hymns could not be understood as simply a mechanism of colonization. Rather, they represented Mohican efforts at sustaining community through ceremonial practice. Likewise, our 21st century project to resound these hymns was necessarily deeply collaborative and relational, bringing together scholars, musicians, and community members who had all found their way to the Mohican hymns for quite different reasons. It was our desire to hear the hymns of Box 331 that led us to record three different versions of eight of those hymns, two done in collaboration with members of the Stockbridge community. The stark differences in these three sets of recordings represents a sort of oral shorthand for the varied ways in which we might approach 18th century musical texts, particularly those that originate in Native communities. Hearing these hymns in three modes has helped us to appreciate more fully the silences that loom over the voluminous Moravian records. Moravian missionaries wrote far more about Native people than did their Anglo-Protestant counterparts, yet volume alone cannot make up for the paucity of Native voices. Reconstructing the performance practices of Native Christians is virtually impossible using these records. By contrast, the available documentary record regarding European Moravian musical practices is both broad and deep. The extensive mission records include only a scant few references as to how the Mohican singers sounded, leaving us to wonder whether they adapted Moravian musical aesthetics or how their singing of the hymns reflected Native musical traditions. So I'm going to share with you these three different sets of recordings, and we're also going to be watching two films with footage featuring some of the different collaborators on this project. Our first set of recordings resounds the Mohican Moravian hymns using information on performance practices gleaned from Moravian sources. These recordings hew closely to 18th century Moravian ideals of musical worship and were produced by the early music choir at Florida State University. They reflect our best understanding of how the hymns would have sounded if we assume adherence to the ideals of 18th century European Moravian music for worship. But before we could proceed with recording the hymns and singing them, we had to confront the challenge of the language. It quickly became clear we could not simply rely on the German phonetic representation of the language from the 18th century hymnals, which you can see at the top. How proficient were missionaries in Mohican? Could Mohican sounds even adequately be represented with German phonetics that were used in the hymnals? Were the missionaries attuned to the subtleties of the Mohican language? Because Mohican has long been a sleeping language, we turned to linguist Chris Harvey for assistance. Working with historical archival sources and his study of related Algonquian languages, Chris was able to provide us with spoken word recordings of our selected hymns and updated transcriptions using IPA, the International Phonetic Alphabet. He also corrected the grammar and orthography of the Moravian versions of the hymn texts. So here you can see on the left-hand side, the English translation. In the middle is Chris's updated version of the Mohican text. And then on the side, you can see a transcription from the archival source. And I'm just going to play a recording of Chris speaking this text.
Jesus Pasquin kia, Nyahgweche menin ta, kia machchek pinhamen. Gahna gamache noch ganab. Getawahan machane pap guayan. Nick wonk kepigachkanum. Nahakai awak tayum. O santa mawe. Jesus.
In addition to the language, the absence of information on the hymn tunes mentioned in the hymnals posed an additional challenge in reconstructing the hymns as sounded pieces of music. There were no chorale books on this side of the Atlantic containing the tune repertory that would have been in use in Moravian communities in Pennsylvania, New York, or Connecticut in the mid-18th century. Fortunately, during a research trip to the Moravian archives in Herrnhut, archivists Paul Peuker and Rüdiger Kroger helped me to locate several small manuscript chorale books from that time period. They were undated, but Peuker and Kroger used contextual clues to date them to the 1740s and 1750s. So, consulting with the Herrnhut chorale books allowed me to reunite some of the Mohican text with contemporary versions of the chorale tunes. Before the hymns could be sung, however, the chorale manuscript needed to be decoded from the original figured bass version, which included, as you can see in this image, only the bass and soprano parts and the numerical figures representing the harmonic structure. So, to accomplish this, I enlisted the help of Joshua Tanis, who was then a doctoral student in music theory at Florida State. Josh wrote alto and tenor parts for the singers and ensured that the hymns were singable and harmonically correct according to Moravian musical principles and standard harmonic and voice leading rules for 18th century counterpoint. So, using Josh's additions, I worked with my students in early music to sing and rebalance the text settings and musical underlay for the Mohican words using Chris's spoken recordings and IPA transcriptions to produce a final edition of the music. Weeks of rehearsals followed, conducted by ethnomusicology student Drew Griffin and accompanied by organ student Teodora Mitse-Sirtsiomaru on a continual organ, which could imitate the quiet sound of 18th century Moravian organs. During this process, I also coached the singers on the aesthetic practices of Moravian singing. And finally, in February 2018, we held a recording session with engineer John Haddon, a specialist in early music recording on the FSU campus. And so I'm going to share with you one of the recordings from that session. This is the hymn Jesu Paschkun Kia, which you just heard Chris speak in the previous recording. So this is the early music choir at Florida State University singing an 18th century chorale version of Jesu Paschkun Kia. So, as you can hear in this first set of recordings, we consciously privileged Moravian musical practices when filling in the gaps created by these enigmatic hymn texts. In doing so, we adhered to typical practices of historically informed performance of 18th century music, which typically relies on written documents. So, our FSU recordings strove to recreate the Moravian aesthetic that encouraged singers to sing, quote, as if there were only one voice, so that the focus of the singing was upon the group and not on the individual voices, end quote. We knew Mohican singers incorporated these musical and aesthetic practices when singing Moravian hymns in multi-ethnic gatherings of Moravians, but because archival records preserving information on the performance practices of the Mohican hymns are particularly sparse, we cannot determine if native singers might also have chosen to incorporate Moravian musical practices in their hymn singing. We also knew that several Mohican Moravians received extensive training in European musical practices, but the archives remained silent on how their previous knowledge of indigenous musical practices influenced their performance of native hymnody. In the end, we realized if we relied on our knowledge of Moravian musical styles to fill the gaps in the historical record, we might effectively be replicating the silencing of Mohican voices. Therefore, we felt it was important to create additional recordings that would restore Mohican voices to the reconstruction process. Building cautiously from what we knew of Northeastern Native musical practices and contextual evidence from the Moravian mission records, we began to construct a picture of how Mohican Moravians participated in hymnody during the 18th century, and especially how they did so in ways that carried on the function of native communal and ceremonial music. Communal hymn singing served as a means of preserving community among and between various native communities and of forging new ties with European settlers in the face of the pressures of colonialism, while also being an occasion of giving thanks to the spirit beings who provided for the well-being of the community. Just as traditional practices, such as the big house ceremony, forged and reinforced communal ties at the time between the community and their neighbors, hymns seem to have served a very similar function. So our second set of recordings was made at the Church of the Wilderness in Buller, Wisconsin, and is located on the Stockbridge Reservation. And like our first set, this set of recordings was more about the insights gained through the collaborative process of singing hymns together than producing a specific musical or aesthetic product. In this case, the recordings were intended to assist with the community's ongoing efforts of language revitalization and engagement with Mohican history. They were also intended to serve as a resource for ongoing study of Mohican language hymns for use by the congregation. These recordings present reharmonized versions of the original chorale tunes by Brent Michael Davids, who is a composer living on the reservation. Brent undertook the work of cultural translation to render the 18th century German chorale tunes more accessible to a contemporary congregation affiliated with the Evangelical Lutheran Church of America. It is worth noting that Brent's involvement in this project reflects a long-standing Mohican tradition of valuing community over orthodoxy. While he is himself an avowed atheist and not a member of the congregation, he views his work on this project as supporting his community in their varied religious expressions while connecting to Mohican history and language. In an August 2017 trip to the reservation, Paul Johnson, who is pastor at the Church of the Wilderness, and Church Council President and Tribal Council Member Greg Miller expressed considerable interest in learning Mohican hymns as a way to connect with their heritage and reinforce bonds of community among those who identify as both Christian and Mohican. In response, Brent updated the arrangements and harmonizations, and we ended up creating editions of 8 different hymns. These additions transformed the original 18th century chordal harmonies into harmonies that Brent hoped would be more appealing to a modern church congregation. He also shortened the English translation of the Mohican text so it could be inserted above each musical phrase, and he added chord indications that could be read more easily by guitarists and other musicians familiar with tablature notation rather than standard Western staff notation. The results were flexible, modern versions of the hymns that could be used in a number of different musical contexts. And we'll take a look at a version of Jesu Paschal und Kia in just a moment. It's worth noting, though, that will be a published version of this hymnal coming out from the Moravian Music Foundation this month. It will include all 8 of the hymns in the versions used for the recordings at FSU and the Church of the Wilderness. And those who purchased the hymnal from the Moravian Music Foundation will also be able to buy the accompanying recordings of both versions as a CD or be able to stream those recordings for free through the Moravian Music Foundation's website. So just a little bit more about the Church of the Wilderness recording sessions. So in the summer of 2018, we gathered at the Church of the Wilderness to rehearse the hymns with the congregation, thereby creating a permanent record of Brent's musical settings for future study and use by the congregation. At Brent's suggestion, Rachel and I had also timed our visit for the recording sessions to coincide with a Mohican history seminar, which was held at the North Star Casino nearby. The next day after the conference, we gathered at the church on Mahicanuck Road, whose name recalls the tribe's homelands along the Mahicanutuck or the Hudson River. Pastor Paul and Greg Miller invited the community to the church for a potluck and a day of learning and recording the hymns. After setting up the recording equipment, members of the congregation and broader community began to arrive, ranging from small children to the elderly. Choral students from the University of Wisconsin-Whitewater, recruited by Brent's colleague, choral faculty member Robert Gerenbeck, also arrived to assist in learning the hymns for the recording session. Once everyone had settled in, Greg welcomed the singers and introduced the project. And then we began to learn the hymn, Jesu Paschkundgier. I spoke the Mohican words line by line, and the participants repeated them. And then Amanda O'Donnell, one of the choral students, rehearsed each of the four parts, the soprano, alto, tenor, and bass, with the singers. We practiced each hymn several times, and then we recorded them with Brent serving as recording engineer. Over the course of a day, we were able to record all eight hymn verses with a break for a shared lunch. And here you'll be able to see the first page of Brent's version of Jesu Paschkundgier, and we'll also be able to hear the recording from that day in June 2018 at the Church of the Wilderness. In addition, I wanted to share with you a 4-minute mini documentary film that we produced about our work with the Church of the Wilderness. So we'll give you a better sense of the recording session, people involved, and what it meant to the participants to sing these hymns. All of the recordings and the films that I'll be showing today are available on a website, which I'll share with you at the end of the presentation. Here is a 4-minute documentary featuring some of the footage from that recording session.
Processes and different administrations and ways to civilize us and do all kinds of things. We became different denominations of Christianity and all those different things. But speaking from my heart, I can tell you that the Mohican people, they always kept that common belief. They always knew right from wrong. Each one of us is born with all that we need to know. We don't need the Bible. We don't need to argue about all different kinds of things, what's right, what's wrong. It's in our heart. We know what our parents taught us. It's been a long time since Mohican language in the form of a hymn sing has been done. So I'm sure we're gonna mess up along the way. I'm sure the pronunciations is gonna be wrong. Somewhere up there in the sky, our ancestors is gonna be going, what? But we all gotta start.
The latest edition of these Mohican language hymns, and today we are going to sing one of them. Now, I was here yesterday, we sang all 8 of them, and we did it absolutely flawlessly from the first go. And so we're going to get to use that language, and we're going to sing again in the Mohican language. So just like honoring the name of John and making that something special, we're going to honor our ancestors and use their words. May Patamawas guide you and keep you. May Patamawas' face shine on you and be gracious to you. May Patamawas look upon you with favor and grant you peace.
In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Spirit that makes us one.
One second, I'll get back to the video there. Okay, now we're back on track again. So during our visits to the Stockbridge Muncie community, several themes became clear from conversations with members of the community and the congregation that suggested a remarkable survivance of Mohican community and lifeways from the 18th century to the present. Maintaining relationships with spirits, with ancestors, with other Native communities, and with broader communities across the United States was clearly an ethical and spiritual priority. The community saw their Christian identity not as a break from a Mohican past, but a continuation. And I think this idea continues to find expression in the church's liturgical use of the Mohican term Pachtamawas, the one to whom we pray, to represent the concept of God. For Greg and other church members, speaking and singing Mohican provided a sense of connection to, quote, the old folks and what they went through, as well as the opportunity to learn from our ancestors, end quote. As Greg expressed, quote, singing these songs that our ancestors probably never heard for over 200 years made my heart grow fond, end quote. The collaborative recordings made at the Church of the Wilderness in June 2018 serve several intersecting, but not identical aims. For the community, the recordings were an opportunity to reconnect with the language and with the music of their ancestors. As scholars, we hoped our work could serve community aims as well. We also recognized that our scholarship was transformed by engagement with community members who generously shared their perspectives on the contemporary legacy of 18th century mission projects. Finally, the third set of recordings of the Mohican hymns was done in collaboration with contemporary Stockbridge Mohican musician Bill Miller. Bill is a singer-songwriter and Grammy-winning musician whose music spans multiple genres From traditional Native American flute to classic rock, blues, gospel, sacred music, and hymnody. Like 18th century Mohicans involved in the development of a Native Moravian hymn tradition, Bill views his work as a musician and artist as spiritual work done in service of his community, broadly conceived. The constant of Bill's long career has been a melding of musical genres and an exploration of the complex racial and religious history of the United States through the lens of his own experiences as a Stockbridge Mohican of Native American and German American ancestry. Bill's music resonates powerfully with a wide audience because he calls attention to the sometimes painful, sometimes creatively inspired cultural conflicts that are foundational to our country's history. In Bill's words, participating in this collaborative project became a means of building, quote, a connection between me and my past and America, end quote. In Bill's recordings, he set several 18th century Mohican hymn texts to new music that reflected his adaptations of traditional Native musical forms. Bill began to work on the hymns in April 2018 when he gathered with Rachel, Chris, and myself in preparation for a public presentation and performance at the Idle York Museum of American Indians and Western Art in Indianapolis, Indiana. Over the course of a few days, we worked together in a basement classroom on the campus of Indiana University, Purdue University, Indianapolis, to pool our separate but overlapping stores of knowledge. Chris coached Bill on pronunciation of the Mohican words, and Bill recalled phrases he had learned from his elders as a child. I talked about the Moravians' ideas on the spiritual purposes of communal singing, and Rachel shared bits of research from Moravian archival records about how and when the hymns had been created and sung by Mohicans in the 18th century. Bill's memories of learning to hunt with the older men of his community and their practice of singing to the deer were remarkably parallel to accounts of Mohican elder Joshua and other Mohican men speaking of the spiritual inspiration behind their singing and their practice of singing hymns while hunting. Again and again in the course of our rehearsals, Bill stressed the importance of listening to his elders, who encouraged him to listen in the woods as he learned to hunt, to his musical teachers who taught him to listen to the sounds of nature in order to learn to play the flute, and to Chris while shutting his eyes to better hear the sounds without the distraction of the written word. Bill made this connection to listening explicit, linking these various acts of listening to finding the inspiration to put new music to the words of the Mohican verses. Quote, "It's very sacred to me, and I know what I heard in the woods with the other hunters. I know what I heard at powwows with old men, how they sing, and that's what I did in these recording sessions," end quote. When he started the process of learning the Mohican hymns, Bill preferred not to listen to the German chorale tunes that had originally been used to sing the Mohican texts. The result was a very different musical take on the pieces that helped us to appreciate the extent to which the original chorale tunes had exerted a sonic presence that almost overshadowed the Mohican voices of Jesu Paschgon Kia and other hymns. Bill's versions of the hymns provide a new way to experience and hear the texts themselves. Since his versions were created through improvisation, there was no need to transform them into notated pieces of music. The oral nature of Bill's versions also allows the possibility to transform future iterations of the hymns into different combinations of texts and tunes that reflect new ideas about the meanings of the Mohican words. And here I'll play Bill's version of the hymn that we've been listening to throughout this presentation, Jesu Paschgon Kia.
Jesu Paschgon Kia, ne agwe che minanda, ya mach che kapin hamin, kahana makke no kana, kato ahan macha ne bap guayin, ne gwan kipa kap kanu, Ahagaiwaktayum. Osantumwe. Osantumwe.
In the end, Bill's recordings were one culmination of years of collaboration and ultimately inspiration. His versions of the hymns should not be heard as replicating the sounds of 18th century Mohicans. Rather, his recordings privilege his voice as a contemporary Mohican Christian musician resounding sacred ancestral texts. For Bill, as for his Mohican ancestors, music has long translated experiences of spirit into sound, offering a means to call down spiritual power and build community. And here I'm going to take a pause and allow us to look at a 12-minute project documentary that was produced by Rachel Wheeler and myself to kind of capture some of the footage of the different recording sessions and the people who participated in them. So this documentary, as I said, is about 12 minutes long, and then I'll be back with some concluding remarks for this presentation.
Three recordings of the hymns in three different versions. So we've got Sarah's historical recording, which is done sort of a la Moravian, in the Moravian 18th century style. And to me, that kind of represents what has happened in the archival records. We could reproduce that music based on the historical archival material we have available that tells us about how did Moravians do their music. And we could reproduce that. And then here at the Church of the Wilderness, we're doing the modernized arrangements with those same tunes with the congregation of a descendant community, a related community. So for that community, the hymns mean something very different, potentially, that here's a chance to connect with their ancestral language and with an ancestral version, an 18th century version of Mohican Christianity. And then the third recording that we've done is with Bill Miller at an event at the Eitelsdorf Museum in Indianapolis, where he worked on creating new music, not tied to the Moravian hymn tunes, to go with the Mohican texts. And symbolically, that to me was a restoration of a Mohican voice that was absent from the historical recording that we did.
These hymns from the Moravian archives are some of the only written records of the Mohican language that exist. It's our hope that by singing these pieces again, by making the text available in a way that is more accessible, that it will assist in language revival efforts that are already going on in the community.
Just play the D.
To me, it's like a prayer language, because it's a separate language now for me. And when I say it, I feel I'm stepping down a sacred ground. I'm going in, that was a language that's way before the United States ever became the United States. And yet we can still touch it. It's like finding seed from the past. All of a sudden, it's been there in the ground for over 100 years, and you found it, you can grow that plant again.
Yesu Pasquan Kaya Neagwe Cheminenda.
The Moravian Church is a German Protestant denomination. They were founded by a German nobleman, Count Nicholas Ludwig von Zinzendorf. During the early 18th century, he developed this idea that if you improvised hymns, either the music or the text, that would give God a chance to enter into your life.
Based upon archival records from Moravian communities, we know that they sang very slowly and very softly. And no one's voice was supposed to stick out because it's not about you. It's about the group and about singing together and about allowing the divine to sort of come through your body and to sing through you.
So he and his wife Bathsheba wrote a number of the hymns that we have, and this was part of a series that was talking about the power that comes from the wounds of Jesus.
So I'm sure we're going to mess up along the way. I'm sure the pronunciations is going to be wrong. Somewhere up there in the sky, our ancestors is going to be going, what?
The small hymnal that we ended up making for the Church of the Wilderness, which we sang together and recorded, was a collaborative project that involved not just Rachel and I, but also Brent Michael Davids, who is a composer living on the reservation. And he was able to take the 18th century German chorale tunes and reharmonize them in a way that sounds very modern and approachable for a 21st century church congregation.
The hymns were sort of fluid in a way. They would do different versions of them or different, change lyrics around and do different versions of these hymns. So they were kind of not static things like we think of a hymnal where they are all printed and they're permanent in a way. These are more fluid. But the manuscript that I saw was, it was in old style music notation that we don't really use anymore. So I just made the comment that I said, oh, these are interesting, but they're not really usable now. Like congregations wouldn't know how to sing this notation anymore.
Good, one time through sopranos from the beginning. Pa-quike, ready. Pa-quike, a-son-like. A-wan-et-na-ta. Wa-che-so-gah-nak.
I called my mom, and my dad both loved music, and we came here to learn some of our tribes. We'll learn the language. I hope to learn this from my ancestors and learn more about my tribe.
I came here, a friend of mine, Rachel Wheeler, who I've known a long time, she's very interested in my tribe, and she knows the history about the language. So she asked me a while ago if I'd be interested in coming up here to record or try to learn some songs of my tribe in our language.
What I bring to the project is I can understand what the words mean in Mohican. And they're not always the same as what they were in the original English or the original German. Or sometimes you can tell that this was written by a native speaker, or this was written by somebody translating because they make simple mistakes or that sort of thing. So that was why I was invited to come down. But since I've been here, I've worked, you know, fairly closely with Bill and Sarah and Rachel. And I think we have a really wide range of interests, and I think we make a good team. Each of us is bringing something unique to the table. and we've gone and recorded a song.
So the asan is your strong?
Yeah.
So asanayik, the strong one. So they're not just any pagwayik. They're not just any wound, they're strong wounds. And you can see the yik at the end in both of them is the thing that is. So the thing that is a whole is the thing that is strong.
So the reason I was invited here was because I have a background in the language and I can understand the words. But the reason why I came here is because I've met comrades, colleagues, I've met friends who I'm going to hopefully work with for a good long time, and we'll carry this project forwards and forwards, and who knows where it's going to go.
Something that I've come to discover in this process is just how valuable it is to work collaboratively. I'm a historian. Most of my work had been done in archives, reading 18th century manuscripts, and it's been fascinating.
The idea was that this recording would restore what was missing from the 18th century Moravian version of these hymns, which was a sense of a Mohican voice.
I know how Native men sang, and I grew up with them, so I had to go back and think, well, if I was hunting, and I was going to say a hunting prayer, God help me get a deer or whatever, how would I sing? And I'm walking, and I'm going to go back and back and back to the 1700s and go back and back into the woods where I grew up, and I'm going to go back and see, how did these people feel? Then the melody came to me. So what we're going to do is play, this is the first version, it's going to continue to grow.
Yesu Pasquan Kia Ni Agwe Chimin and Yamach Chekapin Hamin Hahana Make no Kana Katoahan Machane Bapwayan
But today, singing these songs that our ancestors probably never heard for over 200 years made my heart grow fond and grow many memories. So we thank this project for coming together, recognizing that we are not the last of the Mohicans, that the Mohicans are not gone. They are still here.
The various methods of musical reconstruction that we deployed in these three different sets of recordings help us to hear more clearly the presences and absences of 18th century textual sources. Using the standards of European-based historical performance in Moravian communities for the first recordings, we were able to make use of the rich Moravian records to create what might mistakenly be seen as a highly authoritative musical reconstruction. But in the end, the Germanness of the musical sounds almost completely overshadows the Mohicanness of the words and the Mohican contribution to the creation of the hymns. We caution that this first set of recordings should remind listeners of the silences of archives rather than persuade us that we were stepping back in time to hear history. Had we stopped with this recording, we would have encouraged perhaps this misunderstanding. Our second set of recordings was produced in collaboration with the Congregation of the Church of the Wilderness. It speaks to the ways that Native communities past and present navigated the mixing and melding of inherited tradition with new resources, and how they do so with the aim of reinforcing community ties. The recordings produced with the congregation, like other recordings, were not created as musical products, but rather document the active engagement of the community in the process of constructing historical memory, strengthening communal ties, and revitalizing the Mohican language. And finally, the third set of recordings represents the experiences of one Mohican man and musician whose process of setting centuries-old Mohican words to his own music was itself a powerful spiritual experience fueled by his lifelong efforts to create community through music. While these collaborative methods have significant potential, they also posed a set of challenges that were quite new to Rachel and I as historians. This includes acknowledging that there are multiple viewpoints and perspectives on archival sources like the Mohican Moravian hymns within the Stockbridge community. For many, the legacy of Christian missions among Mohican communities is one of tremendous loss and pain. And so there is an understandable desire not to revisit the personal and cultural trauma of Mohican experiences with missionaries. The different resonances of these sources for members of the Stockbridge community highlight the fraught nature of Native adaptations of Christianity and the ongoing impact of colonialism for modern descendant communities. But the commitment to work collaboratively also pressed us to reflect on the utility of academic scholarship beyond the academy and the extent to which it serves contemporary communities. As scholars, we have been accustomed to writing for those who share common disciplinary commitments, but our work with Native communities and individuals who have an altogether different investment in the sources has pushed our work in new directions. As non-Native academics and as cultural descendants of European American settlers, this project had a different resonance for us than for our Mohican partners. The result for us was a move toward prioritizing relationships in our scholarship, relationships with texts, with other scholars, with communities who also have a stake in the production of scholarship and the history of these sources. This approach only became more valuable as we committed to a different set of priorities and methodologies, and it was far more generative than approaching these hymn manuscripts from a single disciplinary perspective. The resulting recordings inexorably shifted our understanding of our historic subject, helping us to appreciate in new ways both the losses inflicted by colonialism and reflected in the archival silences, but also the survivances, which we likely would not have seen or heard if we had remained in our disciplinary academic silos. Our desire to hear these hymns and to sing them again has not been motivated by a quixotic desire to capture the past as it really happened or as it really sounded, but by the conviction that the process itself of collaboratively investigating hymns draws on the insights and methods of multiple disciplines, as well as collaborations with descendant communities. And that in and of itself generates important questions that shape our interpretations of 18th century Mohican Moravian hymnody, as well as our understanding of the contemporary significance of these hymns. Historical repertories like the Mohican hymns reflect the fluidity of repertories and musical practices across centuries, and they reveal the often hidden labor of Native musicians and hymn writers, as well as the necessity of collaboration in sounding them and appreciating fuller range of their meanings today. The resounding of the hymns stands as oral testimony to the rich and multifaceted meanings that historical music documents, and especially repertories of congregational song, might represent. Throughout this project, we have been reminded of the words of Abenaki basket maker Judy Dow. We all have pieces of the puzzle, and it is only by coming together that we can hope to reconstruct the full picture. If you would like to listen to different versions of the hymns as recorded by the Early Music Group here at FSU, I would encourage you to visit the website of my recently published book. It's called Moravian Soundscapes. It's a sonic history of the Moravian missions in early Pennsylvania. It is a whole book-length study of of hymnody within the context of the Moravian missions from 1741 to 1782. And if you go into the area of the website, which represents chapter 3 of the book, Sound and Spirit, you'll find recordings of these Mohican hymns and a whole musical worship service called a Singstunde, a singing gathering, which consisted of hymns sung around a particular theme. There are also sound maps and other recordings of hymns embedded throughout the website. It is moraviansoundscapes.music.fsu.edu. Again, moraviansoundscapes.music.fsu.edu. And you can also buy the book from Indiana University Press or off of Amazon or any other book retailer. Thank you for listening to this presentation, and I would encourage anyone who has questions to reach out to me. My email address is S as in Sarah, EYERLY at FSU, Florida State University.edu. Again, SEYERLY at FSU.edu. Thank you.